Okay, we're recording. So the first thing I'd like to do before we go any further is to mention the sponsors today, which are the sponsors are the people that make it all possible. So Age&Opportunity, the HSE, Creative Ireland and the Creative Ireland Fund and the Arts Council. So just to mention that to you, it'll be in the, there will be a, we're going to use a PowerPoint presentation. I know some of you haven't been here before. I'm going to screen share a PowerPoint presentation with, which is kind of my, like if you like my script, it helps to keep me anchored and keeps me on script. I will go off script in various different places, but I find using a PowerPoint presentation just keeps my thoughts going in a straight line, if you like. And the sponsors are mentioned, the Bealtaine at Home Festival is mentioned, and also I should point out as well that this isn't the only thing that's available through the Bealtaine at Home Festival. There are other activities that you can take part in from home, and they're available on the Bealtaine website, which I think is bealtaine.ie, isn't it, Bridget? Yeah,
and yes, Bealtaine.ie, yeah.
And also Age&Opportunity.ie as well. So you can find out, if you want to take part in anything else as part of the Arts Festival, you can check out either of those two websites. And again, as I say, you don't need to write them down. They'll be in the presentation that you're going to get in the morning after this. So just to introduce myself a little bit for those of you that weren't here last week, and also because I love to talk about myself. my name is Brian Cooney. I'm a visual artist. I'm as you can probably tell, I'm from Dublin originally. I'm based in Sligo in the northwest of Ireland. I came to the arts late. I studied for a degree. I started studying when I was 40, which isn't today or yesterday, even though the beard kind of hides my age, but or maybe it doesn't. I started studying late for a degree via distance learning in photography, and I finally got it across the line and graduated in 2019. And also to mention that I was lucky enough in 2019 to be awarded an artist in residence in a care setting in St. John's Hospital here in Sligo, also in 2019, which is a... an artist in it's an artist residency that's run by Age and Opportunity. It was a really great privilege, and I learned so much from the experience. So that's all about me. Okay, so one thing I'd like to say as well is just to mention the reason that I'm doing this is because I wanted to contribute to help people who, like myself, are stuck at home or, you know, within 2 kilometers / 5 kilometers from home. We can't go anywhere. And I wanted to help to keep people occupied, to inspire them, to give them something to make photographs about, to make photographs around, to talk about photographs, to look at photographs, to share. And that was really my main motivation. And that's why I really thrive off all the contributions. So far, every week, we've had fantastic contributors with really good and informed things to say about the work that we looked at each week. So please don't be afraid to step forward and say what you think. So I'm just going to, if you just bear with me now, I'm going to screen share the PowerPoint presentation that I have lined up. So just bear with me, and I'll just double check in a second that that you can see it. Can you see that?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. No problem.
Brilliant. Okay, as I said, Bealtaine at Home Festival. And then down below, you've got the two links. You'll be getting this in the morning, so you don't have to write anything down. You don't have to worry about taking notes. So each week, the next thing I've done is to talk about some places that I've found inspiration. Now this week there's more than usual, and I'll just run through them very quickly. The first one is this one here, Angels of Desire, the Storyville Portraits of Ernest James Belloc. Okay, for those of you that weren't here last week, we discussed Ernest Belloc's portraits. Storyville was the red light district of in, where was it, Ed? It was destroyed in Hurricane Catherine. New Orleans.
New Orleans.
Yeah.
New Orleans, yep.
Storyville was the red light district of New Orleans. And after he died, a whole trove of images of Ernest Bellocq's work was discovered, basically thrown to one side and forgotten about. And it's a very famous piece of work. Last week we were talking about portraiture, and we'll get to the assignment in a minute, but a lot of it was inspired by some of the portraits. So this is an essay on the work, which I found very interesting. It's by a critic whose name is Jerry Badger. I'll just click on this link. It should just come straight up. Okay. Can you see that?
Yes.
Nothing has changed, has it?
Nothing has changed.
Yeah. Okay. Hang on a second.
Oh, technology.
I'll have to stop screen sharing and then screen share. Oh. Okay. Jerry Badger's Angel of Desire, the Storyville Portraits. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Okay, so... So one of the things that you would do as a visual artist quite a lot is, if you find something, piece of work that you really like, or that really resonates with you, that you're interested in, you would normally spend a bit of time researching the context, the work, what people say about it. You'd obviously spend time looking at the work, but this is a very good, I'd say there's a lot of stuff on the internet about the Storyville portraits. I found this excellent, a really well written piece on the work. Jerry Badger is a well known critic in the UK, and he writes very well. So you don't need to worry about the website or the address or anything like that. It's going to be in the it's going to be in your presentation that you get tomorrow. Okay. The next thing that I found really interesting this week. In fact, I was going to include it last week, but decided I'd keep it. This is a series of artist talks by contemporary visual artists. It's called Screen Walks with the Dazzle Club. And one of them I'm going to show you later on. This one here, Joanna Mall. Her piece in her talk here is called The Data Brokers. It's related to what we were talking about last week. And I won't go any further than that. Again, you have the link. There's a lot of stuff in here. This guy here, can you see Alan Butler? I don't know where you can see my cursor is down here.
Yeah,
Alan Butler.
Except print.
Huh?
I can only see print. I can't see any pictures.
No, it's only print. You have to click on the link. I'm not going to click on the link here, okay? But you'll have the link to this page, and then you can scroll through the different talks. Alan Butler is a very interesting Irish visual artist. I haven't looked at most of these, but it's something to get around to. Okay. Does anybody here like podcasts?
Yeah.
Haven't come across any.
Okay. So the Lyric Feature, does anybody know Lyric FM?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They do a really good arts podcast. Excellent arts podcast. Called the Lyric Feature. Every single week, it's always really, really, really interesting. Then the latest one is on Maria Edgeworth. I don't know whether people know Maria Edgeworth. She was a contemporary.
Castle Rackrent.
Yeah, Castle Rackrent on Edgeworthstown. So, but in particular, the best ones that I've heard so far this year are Ireland Portrayed, which is about visual art and picturing Irishness, if you like, and how Irish identity has been expressed visually over 300 years. There's a link in the thing I recommend. I really recommend that podcast. There's three episodes in it, and they're all good. Journey to You. This is Dragana, I don't know how to pronounce her second name, Jurisic. She is originally from Yugoslavia, and in the very first Photo Ireland Photo Festival, she had a piece, I think it was actually called Journey to You. And it's about how Yugoslavia, she grew up in Yugoslavia, she experienced the war, she lives in, or I think she lives in Ireland now. When she fled Yugoslavia, she was given asylum here, but it's a really good podcast. She is a photographer. She had a piece of work in the gallery of photography last year. which escapes me right now, but it's an excellent podcast. I highly recommend it. This one, Stranger Than We Thought. I think there's only one in this one. This is a fantastic podcast. It's about the avant-garde, a group of artists who practiced away, I suppose, and never really made it onto the radar, but it's a fantastic, really interesting podcast. And I highly recommend it. Again, there's a link there. And I came across this. So this is an article in the Irish Times. The headline is, Kerry Photographer's Work is Quiet and Hard to Read, Yet Persuasive and Memorable. It's by Samuel. It's a piece of work. It's available online in the Carlin Gallery. There's a link there'll be a link in your document. The photographer's name is Samuel Lawrence Cunan. And he's bases himself in Kerry, but I just love the photographs. I mean, I love that. Can you see that photograph? It's called Small Trap.
That's brilliant. Good morning.
Okay. The Carlin Gallery's website, it has a better image of it here. Okay. His work is just really, really interesting. He's very much interested in the banal and the ordinary. I really like this one here. And again, that reminds me of another American photographer whose name escapes me. But you know, it's funny how you can always correlate what you see, the visual influences in it. I've given you a link to the Irish Times and also the exhibition on the Carlin Gallery's website. We spoke about the Martin Parr Foundation last year. He has a video interview tomorrow. It's free, but they're asking for contributions with Stuart Franklin. Now, you may not have heard of Stuart Franklin, but I think you'll know do you remember? I thought the image was here, actually. You might remember. Who remembers Tiananmen Square? Anybody remember Tiananmen Square? You know, when the...
Yeah.
You remember the famous photograph of the tank and the man who stood up? Stuart Franklin is the photographer who took that photo. So again, there's a link. You can still sign up. There are still tickets available. You can see here on the right-hand side, it says, please pay what you can afford. £3, £5, £10. I think there's still... Booking's closed 27th of May, 1 p.m. That's tomorrow. Okay, so I'm not sure if I can make it, but if I can, I'm definitely going to look that one up. So I'm going to just go back to our presentation now. Okay, I'm just going to come out of these web pages and go back to the document that I drew up. To keep me on script, so.
Brian, what was the name of the photographer in Kerry again?
Samuel Lawrence Cunane, C-U-N-N-A-N-E. Don't worry, Linda. You'll get a link to the documents in the you're going to get.
He does take the same kind of photographs I take. Like, I take a lot of photographs just wandering around the place.
Yeah. Yeah,
his work looks really interesting.
I think his work is very interesting here. Yeah. Sorry, who's that? Okay. So last week's assignment. Okay. So it was a two-part assignment. The first part was I asked you to go out and stare. It's a way to educate your eye and more. Stare, pry, listen, eavesdrop, die knowing something. The point of this is really to encourage you to, when you're out and about, put time aside to look. That, I mean, last week we talked about the whole theme last week was about looking. So, you know, I suppose where I'm coming from on this is that, you know, people often think of photography as being about the camera that you carry. You know, and there's this idea that if you buy a better camera, then you'll take better photographs. But really, it's very important to educate your eye. It's the most important thing that you can do. And whether that be when you're out and about, doing your shopping, out in the garden, out walking, going about your daily business in the house, it's to encourage you to, I suppose, look at the world anew. Imagine it the way a child would see it. You know, children never cease to amaze me the way they can see things because I suppose because as adults we've kind of got this kind of jaded view of the world that we already know what's in it and we already know what's there. But it was just to encourage you to really pay attention to what's going on around you. And obviously you can't, do you know what? I was thinking about this morning when I was out walking, and I was thinking about the way, you know, mindfulness is a big thing now, and quite rightly too. So if you're like, this is a form of visual mindfulness, you know, to encourage you to use your eyes to really connect to what's going on around you visually. Notice the light, notice the colors, notice the, you know, the birds, the animals, the plants, and all that stuff that, you know, you think you know what's there, but you can still surprise yourself if you really pay attention. So that was last week. So I don't know whether anybody has any particular things that they want to share. I mean, I saw lots of things. The first thing I noticed was that right now we're surrounded by starlings, and they've all just fledged and left the nest. And I was watching the starlings in the garden all this week, feeding the fledglings. The fledglings are out and about, and they're moving around, and they're following the adults as the adults are foraging for food. And then they're, you know, as well as kind of mock foraging, but the adults are making sure to feed them, and so they're learning as they go, you know. So I noticed lots of things, but that's the one that stands out for me. I also noticed as well, I would say, how I've been walking every day. And so every morning I do the same thing. I have my breakfast, and I'm out the door by 8 o'clock, and I have one, sometimes I have two cameras. And it's funny how you think, you know, walking the same way every single day, that you would see the same thing and then nothing changes, but things are changing all the time. Every day I go out, even between when I say I walk the same way out and the same way back, the route, something along the way has changed, you know, whether it's an animal that wasn't there, or maybe something, you know, an insect that wasn't there, or something has changed in terms of the way the wind is blowing the trees, that, you know, life is always changing, but we are kind of programmed to believe that, you know, I suppose, programmed to believe that it's always the same, you know. So it was just to encourage you to engage in a bit of visual mindfulness. So I don't know whether anybody has anything that they want to share. You don't have to, but if you do, go ahead.
I went for a walk just before we came on Zoom. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can, Michael.
Yeah, and I went around by the Talca River, and I do this off. It takes about a half an hour, and I end up, it's a circular route. And I happened to read before I went out about various cookery programs and foraging. I read about foraging, and I read about nettles. And I decided while I was walking to look out for nettles. Not that I was gone, I wasn't equipped to pick them now, you know. Yeah. But see, years ago they were very prevalent anywhere near the river or in a bush or anything. But surprisingly, I found very, very few of them on the walk around, you know. That was what caught my attention out on the walk. Now, I didn't take any photographs or anything, but
No, you don't have to.
They're always there anyway. But perhaps next time I'll bring a pair of gloves and a bag and stuff a few in and eat them for the first time in my life. You know, I believe they're very beneficial, apparently, you know.
They are. But Michael, one thing you should know about nettles is you're supposed to pick them when they're young. You're probably a bit late now.
I heard that. You have to pick young and fresh, all right, yeah. It might be a bit late.
They make fantastic soup, and they also make fantastic pesto.
Yeah. I heard that, all right. I noticed on the way around was there was a good few people there, mainly very young children and their parents in their, say, late 20s, early 30s. And I've noticed this before, since the coronavirus raised its ugly head, that the younger people don't seem to notice me. I'm invisible. And they don't get out of the way on the path. They don't move aside. Whereas I have to move aside onto the grass all the time, you know. Now, that's something, obviously, I can't record, but certainly every time I go out, I notice that, you know.
Yeah. Very good.
Yeah. That's my observations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Brian?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. This isn't anything that I recorded in my photographs, but I was sort of reminded about in a conversation last night that with the tremendously decreased amount of automobile traffic on the roads around where I live, People are walking in the streets. Kids are riding their bikes in the streets. It's almost like many of the streets have become sort of very pedestrian, which is very great. But it also brings a fear in me that what is going to happen when we sort of return to normal, whatever normal might be. And, people are going to have to start to sort of rethink about safety in some ways. It's just it's the difference is very striking to me.
Mm. Yeah,
absolutely.
I don't know whether I'm imagining it, but like you say about the lack of cars, there's very few cars.
Yeah.
I live in a very rural place, so there wouldn't be a lot of cars around here anyway. But I'm not sure if I'm imagining it, but I think I notice an increase in the amount of insects. Certainly I've noticed that there's a whole lot less roadkill on the road since lockdown. So yeah.
Mm.
Anybody else, or should we move on?
Yeah.
Yep.
Move on. Okay. So we're going to go on now and talk about part two of this assignment. So so part two of this assignment was to make a portrait of yourself, but you cannot show your face. This may be challenging because it's counterintuitive and goes against the grain of what you do if asked to make a self-portrait. Think carefully. What does it mean to show yourself from below the neck only, from behind or as a shadow? To show only an isolated body part. Reflect on the phrase to lose face, also the word deface. If your face is missing, are you devalued or diminished? Bring your thoughts and share them next week. Submit your images so that we can discuss them. Okay? So just be cognizant of, so we're going to share the images, but as interesting, the images are all very interesting. Also, I think those questions, you know, what does it mean to show yourself from below the neck? From behind is a shadow. The phrase to lose face, also the word defaced. A lot of what contemporary photography is about, it's not so much, it is about obviously the medium and how the medium is used, but it is also about the ideas and the concepts behind the medium. So just think about those thoughts and we'll bring them to the discussion when we move on to looking at the work. Actually, I might come back to this. This is one of the artists in... we'll show it now. You see this... if your face is missing, are you devalued or diminished? Okay, so when I was preparing for this assignment, when I was writing it last week or taking it from the book, Train Your Gaze, again, it's on the reading list. You needn't worry about the name of the book. It's on the reading list. That's at the end of this presentation. I started thinking about... you know, the idea of being devalued because your face is not included in the photograph. And then I started thinking about, you know, when you consider how important in Western culture the face is, it's been shown, I'm pretty sure it's been shown by psychologists that, your success in life, it's not directly relatable, but your face has an effect on how successful you are, or can have an effect on how successful you are, even in terms of a partner. You know, there's been research that shows that people match up with people that they consider to be kind of similarly attractive, if you like. So, the face is very important in Western art, Western culture. You can go right back to the Greeks, where it was codified, you know, the face had to be symmetrical in order to be considered beautiful. So I started thinking about the face as a form of currency, you know. Think about all the things that your face gets you access to. It allows you to drive when you put it on your driving license. It allows you to travel when you put it on your passport. If you don't have your face in your driving license, you don't have it on your passport, you can't do those two things, you know. So the face is closely related to identity. Today we have, you know, social media, your profile picture. For instance, I find it interesting on my most, if not all of my social media profile accounts, I don't show my face.
No, neither do I.
Yeah, I have a different face, and that's sort of a game for me.
I always make a point of not having my face on my social media.
Yeah, you wouldn't be alone there, Linda. It's a lot of people don't show their face, you know. There's nothing that it's not deep thought now for me, but like, so for instance, I don't know whether anybody remembers Marvin the Paranoid Android from
Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Yeah. So he's my profile picture on Instagram and also on Facebook. So I'm still saying something by using that image. You know, it's still a form of identity, but I'm concealing who I really am, if you like. So this piece of work by Joanna Moll, I'm going to have to come out of here and go back into the webpage. It's called The Data Brokers. And I just thought it's an interesting thing. I'll just show it to you and then we move on. Coming out. Now I'll just share the webpage. Hang on now. It was on here. Wait a sec. It's one of she actually did a talk as part of the screen shares. Here we'll click on this link. Can you see the screen walkers? Joanna Moll, there it is. Can you see it okay?
Yeah.
I'm just going to click on here.
No photograph, but plenty of text.
I can't see anything.
Okay, can you see the data? Can you see the pages?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I can see it now, all right.
The reason that you'll find text and image together is that they have a strong relationship. So we talked before about... some of you I know were here when we talked about how images are what they call polysemous. In other words, they can mean multiple things depending on the context in which you use them. So if you want, which comes from advertising, you know, if you are advertising something like a set of furniture, or I don't mean now on done deal or whatever. I'm talking about if you're a company like Apple, for instance, and you're showing all these amazing photographs of young people using their phones, you will always find a lot of text because they want to, if you like, make sure that you understand what the pictures mean. If they left the text out, the meaning floats. You can bring your own meaning much more easily to an image. So this is the, we'll look at the project in a minute. I just want to, in May 2017, technical tech and artist Joanne Moll purchased 1 million online data profiles for €136 from US Date, a supposedly US-based company that trades in dating profiles all over the globe.
Does anyone else find that frightening, how easy it is for your photograph online to be sold?
Yeah, it is frightening. So the batch of dating profiles included pictures, almost 5 million, usernames, email addresses, nationality, gender, age, and detailed personal information about all of the people who created the profiles, such as their sexual orientation, interest, professions, thorough physical characteristics, and personality traits. So, I mean, if you like, identity, I suppose, trading in identity, thieving, stealing identity has always existed. But the internet makes it much easier for these things to happen. And so I'll just show you the project just very quickly. So this is, again, for me, this is about how your face is a currency.
Mm.
So this was the ad that they answered. And here are some of the images. And you can see that they've deliberately pixelated the images so you can't really clearly see who they are. Okay.
Yeah,
there you go. So you can actually click on each one.
Cool.
So a lot of these are actually from dating apps. This is going on behind the scenes where nobody knows about it. So, if you like, the internet has introduced, it's also interesting as well, visually and photographically, there's a lot of artists now who are only or who are using the internet to create work. So for instance, Google Street View.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Anybody come across Google Street View? Well, if you think about it, if you're a documentary photographer, Google Street View is an online, easily accessible resource that you can use to make work. So there's a very well-known German photographer. Hang on a second. whose name won't come to me right now, but he's got a large body of work that's just taken from Google Street View. I'll see if I can remember before we finish. But so I just wanted to show them to you, and then we're just going to go back to. Any questions on that before I go back?
I would just say, Brian, given that the source being date and site, one would have to sort of question the honesty of the profiles too.
Yeah. Which I think is very interesting now because, that's a very good observation, okay? Because one of the things that has been said, sorry, Bridget. One of the things that's been said about photography since the very beginning. Sorry, I can just hear there's just a bit of feedback there from somebody's mic. When you go right back in the history of photography to the very beginning, okay, one of the things that was always stressed about photography was its authenticity, okay? Mm. One of the legacies of that time, if you like, is that there's the tendency to believe that what you're seeing is true. And what you say is very true, Ed. And of course, since then, there have been so many artists. For instance, we talked about Cindy Sherman last week, who've traded or whose whole thing is to point out the fact that there is no direct link between truth and photography. That if we tend to believe images, we tend to trust them dependent on the source that has generated them. For instance, traditionally it would have been newspapers. You know, if you bought the New York Times or the Irish Times and you saw a photograph, it wasn't so much that you believed the photograph was true, you believed that the Irish Times or the New York Times was a truthful publication. Of course, the internet has changed all that as well. You know, I'm not suggesting that either of those particular sources are not true, but, you know, even that has been undermined by the internet now. So I'll just flip back to... would anybody else, just before I go, would anybody else like to mention anything or comment on the data brokers? Feel free. Okay. So we're going to go through the work that was contributed now. Okay. I don't know whether all the people are here, but I've got them credited underneath each piece of work. So each week in the... in the PDF that you would have got, in each week's PowerPoint presentation, I've included a link to a PDF that describes how, or a method, if you like, a methodology for looking at artwork and why it's important. So I've just summarized it here, and the link is also in this page when you get the presentation tomorrow. So there are really 5 different things you can do. Obviously, it's not limited to 5, but find 5 main headings. When you see a piece of work, it helps to describe it to yourself, okay? If you're keeping a journal, I would quite often take photographs, print them, put them into my journal, and then I would interrogate them, if you like, to see what is it about this photograph that interests me. Not with every photograph, but with some. So I would describe it. What is it? You know, what does it look like? What are the colors? What are the shapes? Relate to it. Relate to it is really, you know, so we're going to do that with several of these today. So I printed up. So describe and relate it. What kinds of things do you see in the artwork? What words would you use to describe this artwork? What first attracted you to this? What is it that holds your interest? How does the artwork make you feel? Does it remind you of anything? Another artwork, a place, a person, story, idea, or memory. Now, in nearly all of the examples, or most of the examples today, I have an example that I can relate the piece of work back to. What is it about the artwork that sparks these memories and associations? So an important thing to do if you want to be a better artist, a better photographer, is to keep a journal where you make notes and you write about the work. And analyze it, look at the composition, the lines, the shapes, the tones, the colors, the patterns, the textures, what technique, what process was used. Interpret it and put it into context. I was talking about context earlier on. What do you think is happening? Where and when was the artwork created? These are all things that you can just keep in mind as we're talking today, and you can look up the PDF in your own time. What do you know about the artist, their life, their influences, and art practice? was the work originally created as a piece of art? Do you think it has some other purpose, and so on and so on? And evaluate it. Can you classify the artwork and its subjects according to a type? Is it landscape, portrait, still life? Does it depict something recognizable? So for instance, last week when we were talking about Julia Margaret Cameron's work, Michael, you talked about, you evaluated, you talked about the Madonna. You mentioned the Madonna, do you remember? Last week?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, you know, so that's all in terms of relating to it, related to something else, to evaluating it, and so on and so on. So now I just wanted to mention that as we're looking at this work to give you sort of like a stronger foundation to analyze and look at the work that we got from last week. So this piece of work is Marie's response. Is Marie here? It's possible she's not. Marie, is that you?
That's me.
Yeah. Can I just start by saying I think this is fabulous.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful flowers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's also a really interesting portrait. It's like an enigma.
You know? I like the color of your shirt. It's a nice contrast to the greenery all around you.
Well, that's my working t-shirt. I was out in the garden.
Lovely color on you.
Yeah. I'm wondering what the event is.
Yeah.
The event. I got sick in 2017. I spent a month in hospital and they didn't know what was wrong with me. And 6 months later, I found out I had cancer. So I survived that cancer. I got treatment and I had an operation. I had a clear scan. And my second scan after that, I had cancer back again. Mm-hmm. So I had another severe operation last December. So I'm after my first clear scan again, so my daughter gave me a bunch of flowers to celebrate that I'm cancer-free again.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. It's wonderful.
Great.
Yeah. And thanks for sharing that.
Yeah.
I think I'm back gardening again. I wasn't able to for the last few years, so I feel much better now. And I'm out taking photographs and back gardening. So.
Yeah. Good for you.
Yeah.
So in terms of relating it, it reminded me of a piece of work called Terrain by an artist who's called, his name is Jackie Nickerson. I think she's from the UK originally, but she splits her time between South Africa and Ireland now. So would you like to see the work?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I'm just going to come out of here and share the webpage. God, it's cumbersome, isn't it? Hang on. Okay, so Jackie Nickerson, just give me a second to find it here. Here we go. So I'll put this work in context. It's part of an original piece of work about Zimbabwe and farm workers, okay? Which is older. So you can see that these are much more straightforward portraits. Again, there's some of them though where the faces are partially hidden, you know, like down here in the bottom right-hand corner and this one here. And then she went on to subsequently make this piece of work. And you can see that all of their faces are obscured by something.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Which again, Marie, just reminded me of that work when I saw your portrait. Just there's a lot of similarities, you know, like look at these people over here with this guy has, I think it's banana leaves, and you know. So okay.
Very good.
Yeah.
Anybody else like to say anything before we move on?
It's reminding me, I think it's René Magritte with the apple in front of somebody's face in the photograph.
And he's had a big influence on contemporary art.
I believe I watched years ago, I watched a profile on him.
Yeah, he was a surrealist. Let me just go back to but that's a very good reference, Magritte. Okay. So thanks again, Marie, and that's a very good reference there on Magritte. So this is Michael's response. So there's a couple of different images here. Can you see it, everybody?
Yeah. Yeah.
Let me just go to full screen. Into full screen. Okay. Can you see it now?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. So there's Michael submitted a couple of images. This is the first one. Michael, some of these were slightly cropped when I put them into the slideshow here. So this, the top of your head is just cut off, and that there's nothing I could do about it.
Okay.
I really like this one. It connects with last week. I know.
Yeah.
I really like that. And this one I really like too.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I like the shading in that.
Mm.
Yeah.
Or the shadow, I mean.
Yeah.
I was going to submit it in colour, and I thought black and white would be perfect. For it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Lovely.
Thank you.
Those doors behind you?
Pardon?
Are those doors?
No, that's a window blind.
Ah, okay.
Large window.
Yeah, there's a real story in this one.
And it got me using my camera self-timer for the first time, actually, you know. I've never used it. And my tripod.
That one makes me want to ask you, were you okay? You look like you were crying.
Well, I paused it.
Yeah.
You're thinking.
that was the image I wanted, and that's to hide my face, you know?
Yeah.
The juxtaposition with the angel is very interesting.
Yeah.
It's lovely.
Yeah.
I like that one.
Can I just ask, did anybody find this, the fact that you didn't have to show your face? How did you find that?
Very strange.
Hmm.
Yeah.
That was a very interesting exercise. Mm. It's quite difficult not to show your face, actually. The temptation is to show your face all the time.
Yeah. Mm.
Well, I hate being in photographs, so it made it easier for me.
Yeah. Yeah. I also hate being in photographs. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, so do I. Mm. I always say I'm the photographer, not the photography.
Yeah. And then in terms of, you know, the whole idea of if your face is not in the photograph, are you devalued, or, and the idea of being defaced, or, you know, how would you respond to that in relation to the
I think for me, it was more like the associations I made with not showing your face. What came to my mind instantly?
Yeah.
It was not about me, it was more like the world in general. What, you know, like all those people who don't have a face, like metaphorically, who don't have a voice and who don't have a face, who are, because they're born on the wrong track, you know, on the wrong side of the track, or they are in repressive regimes. Or for me, that's what came to my head instantly.
That's really good. That's really rich, Pascal.
Yeah, but it's what I had in my head. I couldn't get rid of it.
And what about being a bit disembodied? You know, one of the questions that was asked, and that was, how does it feel to photograph yourself as a disembodied body part, if you like? Did anybody?
I was struck when I was taking that. I was struck by the bark on the tree. I wanted to give a contrast between my hand, the bark on the skin of my hand and the skin on the tree, as it were, you know.
Oh, yeah.
That was the thing.
Say that, I notice it now. Mm. It's very good, Michael. It's very good.
Sorry?
Yeah.
Textures.
Yeah. When I look at that, to me, it almost looks like you're petting a horse.
Yeah. That's what I thought, too. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's actually only sunlight. It's only sunlight.
Yeah.
To the left of the hand, it's only sunlight, that's all.
Yeah, that's
in the botanic gardens, just down the road from me.
Oh, yeah.
The light and shadows are great.
Yeah.
I took a series of those, but that was the nicest one. The sunlight hand, with my hand facing now, wasn't so appealing, funny enough, you know.
Yeah.
I had a small operation on my hand a few years ago. To open up my hand, it closed in, and that was what I was trying to convey, but it didn't work the other way, and that's where I ended up with.
Mm.
That's very nice.
But I took a couple of others with much rougher bark, and that didn't work out as well, funny enough, you know.
That's often the way.
Yeah.
You have something in your head that you want to convey, and as you have to start working towards it, and sometimes you never get there, but you might get something else.
I have to say, to reveal my source, my son suggested taking pictures of my hands instead of the body, instead, you know, and I think it works better.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Anyone remember the RTE TV show from years ago called Hands?
I do.
I used to love watching that.
Yeah.
Friend, the bookbinder in that was a friend of mine, actually.
Ah, cool.
Yeah. Des Brain. He's long dead now.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thanks for contributing that, Michael. It's really interesting. Each one of them is very interesting. So I'm just going to move on, just conscious of time. Yep. So this is, Ed's response, yes. Now, again, I'm going to have to come out. I couldn't get these to download, so we'll just go to the web pages. So there's... There's... open link. No, hang on a sec. Sharing. Here we go. Okay, so these are... Can everybody see that?
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
So
Ed has submitted three. So there's this one. And this one.
Excellent.
I like the textures in that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's good.
And this one.
That's lovely.
That's a shadow rather than your silhouette, is it?
That's right. See, shadow on the wall from the sunlight coming through the window.
Works very well.
Yeah, it's lovely. It's really good. Looks very professional. That's interesting as well.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Yeah.
Like the number two there, you wonder, is are you about to come in or is it a reflection? Or are you somebody standing out, looking in? Or are you just a reflection of yourself?
Yeah. There's really interesting textures in that one.
Yeah.
Funny.
It's not taken through a cloth, is it?
What's that?
Is that taken through a cloth?
No, it's just in the... Yeah, it's just the again, it's the in the front room of my apartment.
Yeah,
and we call it the sunroom because it gets really, really good sun. It's sort of a celebration of that.
Just,
for the other one, I sort of put it. I pulled up the blind all, and it just got rid of the blind.
I think one of the things I was going to say is, it's funny how different this one and this one are to what you look on the call, how you look in, you know, when you see your face here, you know. Yeah, that one, you could be Art Garfunkel, you know, on
yeah, exactly.
Actually, when I thought of it, I thought it was more mid-60s Dylan, to be honest.
Yeah
I can see that too. Yeah.
I prefer that look.
And what about the questions around, feeling devalued, defaced, things like that? Did any of that, you know, did any of that occur to you? How does it feel to be portrayed without your face?
Well, for the first one, out of my walk, with my mask and my hat and my glasses protecting, I have to be very careful of the sun and my skin. So I'm often very covered up, but. I also felt that it was very generic in a sense that this was an activity and a look that was connecting with people all over the world that were all going through a similar experience now. And you couldn't really, I mean, I can recognize myself, but I think it's too, hyperbole to call it every man, but I think it sort of, it made me feel connected to other people.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody else like to contribute in before we move on? Because Ed has sent us a couple of other pieces that are worth looking at. So the next one is colouring the apartment. I'll just skim through these very quickly. I'm not going to go through Sophie Cowell's chromatic diary or the, you see underneath, I've just called, you submitted a series of signs as well. And I'll just say that's a very interesting series of signs that you contributed. I'll show them to everybody now. And I've sent you here on the document, you'll see Claire Strand Stumped, okay?
Okay.
Very well known. I don't know whether everybody knows or anybody knows who Claire Strand is, but she's a contemporary artist who uses photography. She's very influenced by the surrealists. And she has a Instagram account called Claire Strand Stumped. And much like your signs, it's repetition. It's the same thing, same subject, pictured over and over again. And in this case, they're all tree stumps. And there's a link there. You can have a look at it tomorrow when you get the...
Okay.
So we'll just look at the other two series.
Thank you.
In the apartment. Hang on a second. Now. Okay. Here we go. So, colour in the apartment. This series here you sent. Which is an interesting way, something that you can be beavering away at and working at yourself. It's interesting when you see all of the images in a group like this.
Yeah, it's very good.
It makes them, gives them more weight, I think, when they're displayed like this than if you were to display a single image on its own.
Yeah, it's lovely. It's very nice.
Sort of like a visual.
I like the flowers.
Yeah, it works really well.
Okay. So, and now I'm just going to come out of this and go on to the last series that Ed shared. Hang on a sec. Okay. No. Yeah, here. Same thing. Ed is called Do Not Walk. So they're all signs that you've encountered on your...
Oh, very good.
Which again is... Yeah. It's very interesting when you put them all together.
Yeah.
Sorry, Michael?
Sorry, who took these?
Ed.
Oh, Ed. Very good. I thought you were American, all right, yeah.
Yeah.
Ed has just given me an idea. I'm going to try and get the green crossing man when the next time I go into town.
Yeah. That's
of course, very, do you have the don't walk and don't no, walk?
What I did notice was the lack of Irish. With Irish, yeah. In Ireland, we'd always have the Irish with the English as well, you know?
Yeah.
It's interesting culturally because, you know, I don't think, you know, maybe I'm being a bit... But I don't think you'd find that many signs telling you what not to do, you know, in Ireland. I'm not sure about that, but...
They might be there, but we ignore them.
Exactly. I like the one, no trespassing after dark. So yeah. You can't trespass before it gets dark.
We have a good one here on the lamppost down the road from where I live. When your dog does its business, do yours, meaning pick up after it.
But it's interesting, you know, I think it's interesting how all those small details that we see every day and we don't, you know, we've got this idea again that photography is something that is over the horizon, somewhere far away, and to take interest in photographs, you have to go somewhere exotic, when in fact, they're all around us. And it's a lot of the time, how you just... It's how creative you can be in interpreting, you know, the world around you. Like, for instance, Marie's portrait with the flowers. You can make interesting photographs of what you have right now with your phone, without any fancy equipment, and with all the stuff that's going on all around you. In fact, you know what, Ed, when this whole thing started, you know, we were locked into the house and I was looking for things to photograph. I started photographing the windowsills in the house here, because every single window that is lowered. I haven't finished it, but it made me think I should get back to it, you know. And okay.
And to be honest, this one was motivated somewhat by political culture in the states, where there's sections of the United States where people are saying the government can't tell me what to do.
Yes.
You're taking away my freedom. Where it's right in front of us all the time. Yeah. The agreements that we make with the government about things that we can and cannot do.
But people don't see it. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah. They don't want to see it.
Yeah, they don't want to see it. Yeah, it doesn't suit them. Yeah. It's really interesting. Okay, can I move on? Or does anybody want to say anything else?
No, it's great.
Okay. I'll just go back to the So Pascal. Really interesting response, Pascal. Two images, this one. And this one.
That's another one that reminds me of McGray with the face blocked.
Yeah. You know, Pascal, it's interesting reading this now after you said earlier on about the people who have no voice, the people who have no face. It's interesting the way that was running through your mind. And in this one, you've got your hands behind your back.
Yeah.
No.
I was hoping to, it depends. I was interested in how people would interpret it.
Yeah.
And for me, it was more like nearly a political statement for people who don't have a voice.
Yeah.
You know, who are victims of injustice or literally don't have a voice because they're poor or uneducated and so on. Mm-hmm. But maybe some people would not see that way. I don't know.
Well, I think when you explain the thinking behind it, you can't miss that that interpretation. Even without that, though, I found this one particularly, there's something a bit maybe menacing about it.
Yeah.
You know, it looks like you're in somebody else's power, I suppose. You know.
Yeah.
Like you have no control. Yeah.
That's it. My husband thinks it's weird, photo.
But, you know, I once watched a film called The Last Hangman, and that looks like somebody who's about to be hung, the white cap over their head, their hands tied behind their back.
Yeah, I was thinking of victims of torture or something like that.
It reminds me of someone who has been kidnapped, but the body seems very relaxed, too, so it's that...
I forgot about that.
I wouldn't actually say it looks relaxed, but it doesn't look sprung, ready to, you know, it doesn't look tense, but yeah, it's interesting. Even the body, the way you're holding your body is interesting in it.
Yeah.
There are lots of different cultural references that come to mind. One thing that came to mind for me was, you know, the American hostages in Tehran, you know, in the...
Yeah.
It's very interesting. And this one as well, I think, is interesting. I've given you a reference there as well to a photographer. I'll show you now. I think this one's really interesting too. It's much more anonymized. Hard to tell. You know, what you obviously you're looking at a person, but it's hard to tell much about the person. The only thing that gives away, Pascal, that you're a woman is the hair slide, and even then you can't read that for sure.
Yeah.
And by the way, in my book, weird is good.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you.
Because I'll explain why. Particularly nowadays, because we live in such an overloaded culture, we see photographs and images all around.
Mm.
One way to make people stop and look at the images that you take is to, you know, to be ambiguous. I talked about this before, to withhold information, to make the viewer look, or make the viewer work for their, you know, for their, to find the meaning in the image. You know, it's a strategy, and it's, you see it being used more and more in contemporary art. So I think they are two really good contributions. Before we move on, does anybody want to add anything?
My first reaction when I saw that photograph was, I'd love to be able to bend forward like that.
It reminds me of Michael's, and I'm wondering what the emotion is.
Yeah,
that's what I wanted. That's great, because you see, I could just be tying my shoelace, or I could be in despair over something or whatever.
Mm.
I thought that's what, you know.
Yeah, I think that's a good reading. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Mm. On the bottom, I'm not going to show you the web page now because of the time. Particularly the first one, and the way you're sort of using your body, reminded me of a piece of work that I saw. It must be back in 7 years ago, in 2013. Vivian Sassen is she's a fashion photographer, and I saw an exhibition in the Ireland Photo Festival in 2013 called In and Out of Fashion. And one thing that really struck me about her work is that she plays with the body, in that the models that she uses are often contorted, you know, sort of like almost pieces of sculpture, I suppose. The body's used like a piece of sculpture, and quite often the face is concealed. You know, she plays with this idea, because she's a fashion photographer, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
She plays with this idea that, you know, the model is sort of invisible behind the clothes sometimes. So there's a link there, you can check it out yourself. The In and Out of Fashion is a book. And you can find a website from there, I think. So I'll just show you my response. I have two images that I made. This one.
Yeah.
Is that you as a child?
It is me as a child, yeah.
Okay.
And one thing that I've done quite a lot of work with self-portraits. And self-portraiture, I've used it quite a lot in my personal work. And one thing that always strikes me looking back at family photographs of me is that A, I don't recognize the person in the photograph, and B, I don't remember the photograph. I don't remember the instance. I've got the photograph, but there's no memory behind it. So I was trying to think about ways that I could express that, if you like. So yeah. And I made a whole lot of prints from, I photographed photographs, which again is another thing that I like to do. It's another way I like to play, photographs within photographs. One thing that's said about, I don't know whether everybody's familiar with the term postmodern, but the postmodern world is often referred to as an endless hall of mirrors, that, you know, it's pictures within pictures within pictures. So, it's one thing I like to do. And then the second one was this one here. I have three. This one here. Much like Marie.
Is that a new tattoo?
No. But the scar on my arm is relatively new. And when I put it into the... I broke my arm in 2017. And one thing that really stood out to me when I looked at this is the stitching.
Mm.
Actually, I didn't notice it on the phone, but when I blew it up large, you see the stitching in the t-shirt and the stitching in my arm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah.
So, and then the final one is this one.
That's lovely.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Messing around with my shadow yesterday, and in terms of, did I find not showing my face? Like I said, it's something that I like to do anyway. I like to play around with concealing my face. And so partly because I don't like looking at myself in photographs. And
I thought that was a child.
Yeah, it does look, it's distorted, isn't it? I noticed that yesterday when I was taking it. Yeah, it's distorted because of the way the way the sunlight is behind me there, you know, and it's my shadow on the ground as a wall. Which again is interesting, because if you think, I've noticed a lot lately the way photography flattens 3D space, and you can really see it in that. You know, it didn't look it did look distorted in real life when I was doing it, but it looks much more distorted when you flatten it with a camera or into two dimensional space.
Do you have headphones on?
I do.
You do, okay.
Yeah. You see a camera, I've got a camera over my right shoulder as well.
Yeah, I really like that. I think that's great.
Yeah.
You know,
and it's full of textures.
Yeah, it's full of textures, yeah. Well, playing around with the seam and the concrete, splitting it down the middle, you know, just,
Is it mud? No, it's a grass.
I think
it's mud, isn't it?
No, stones, I think it is. Stones, and you can see some
vegetables. Ah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's at the bottom of a concrete wall.
Okay.
So
cool.
It's great. I really like that.
Yeah. And actually, it's interesting as well, the way it divides. See, the bottom is a triangle. So you've got, you know, you've got a triangle at the bottom, and, you know, so, I mean, if you know anything about rule of thirds or golden ratio, you know, there's this thing that goes back again to the ancient Greeks in terms of proportions within the frame. You roughly divide the frame 2/3 to 1/3. Well, if you look at, it's not a straight, obviously you can divide it vertically or horizontally, and this one kind of does it, it's kind of diagonally, 1/3 at the bottom and 2/3 at the top. And that wasn't done, that was not done consciously, it's only now that I
can see
it. So,
I guess, you know, you can read endlessly into imagery and pictures and how we respond to pictures, and that whole idea of, you can read a lot in, and I have done, you can, there's a lot you can read about composition and how composition works, but that's only just part of it. So
it's very simple at the same time, your photo then. There is nothing to distract except what you took, you know. That's great. I love the tones of grays.
Thank you. Yeah, so it's playing, you know, like, I think sometimes we forget to play, you know. I can't underscore how important it is to go out and play and look at the results you get, and even if you're not happy with them. I mean, I don't know about you, but I could go out for hours and play with a camera, with the frame and what I'm looking at, and even if I don't, you know, even if I don't take the photograph, it's again, like I said, it's like a visual, kind of like a visual mindfulness, you know, to be looking through the frame at what's in front of me, and, you know, and so on and so on. You can spend a lot of time doing that. It's very fun, you know, it's very satisfying. Very satisfying. Okay. So just a couple of things. What time is it now? It's just 4:30, okay? So is Sheila here?
Yeah.
Sheila, did you send in this work?
I did, yeah.
Because it came in last week after the call, and I just wanted to talk about it. It's really in response was it last week's about home or 2 weeks ago? It's a really interesting piece of work, Sheila. I know you said you were sending it in so that I wouldn't think that you didn't bother, but there's one outstanding image in here. I'll get to it in a minute, but every one of these images is interesting and good. Okay?
Right.
So this is the first one. I think there's 4 images in this. So feel free to comment. I'll just because it's 4:20, I'm just going to go through them. Okay? I think this one's particularly interesting because of all the photographs in the photograph. And also the way you framed it. The way it's off kilter. It's sort of disorientating.
I like that.
Mm.
lots of detail, lots of little detail, you know.
I was trying to just capture different activities at home, if you know what I mean, the different things that, well, the different people are involved in.
Well, you did capture it. Like, each one of these images tells a story about your home life and who's there and what you do and how you pass the time, you know. So it's a really good response, Sheila.
Thank you.
I love this image. I've been racking my brains to, it reminds me of somebody else's work, and I just cannot think who it reminds me of. I love the fact that you've got the car just nosing into the image. And I love the fact that you've included the power lines. This goes back to, I don't know, were you here in the very first week when we talked about self-portraiture? The very, very first week, I talked about a photographer, Lee Friedlander. And one of the things he said about himself was that a lot of other photographers would walk 20 meters to get stuff out of the frame, whereas he walks towards all the things like the telegraph poles and stuff like that. And I just I just love this photograph.
I just thought you were saying kind of to show not tell, and
yes,
I thought the paradigm showed that my home was in the city.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean. That I wasn't really thinking about the car so much as the power lines.
Yeah, but I think it's a perfect example of show, don't tell, you know, that you're kind of making the viewer work. You're like, I'm searching for the meaning, you know, in what are you trying to say with it? What does it mean? Or what does it mean to me even? And yeah, it really captivates me, that image. It's a great image.
It's very lush.
Very lush.
Yeah.
Does anybody else want to respond?
I like the way the words are captured, actually. I like the way it's leading your eye up towards it, actually, you know.
Yeah. So thanks very much, Sheila.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to move on. I'm not going to go through these now because it's just 4:30, and I just threw them in. One of the videos that I included last week, a link to, was Jeff Wall talking about how he starts by not photographing. So you'll find a link that will bring you to some background information about Jeff Wall, and then you'll find a link to a Google image page of his images, and also about another artist who I always associate. These two artists, they do what are called staged photographs. Okay, now I have a bit of an issue with the term staged photography, because it, if you like, it sort of implies that it's not real. Would you agree? It sort of says that, you know, these are not real images, and that they're not, if you like, authentic images. Well, I challenge anybody to pick up their, you know, go back and look at your old family album, your family photo album, and nearly every single image in a photo album is staged. I don't know what, you know, I can't think of a type of photography that isn't in some way staged. I mean, even if you go out to photograph the landscape, you choose where to stand, what time you're going to photograph a particular place, you know, which way you're going to face. So in a way, it's all staged. So
I think it depends what you take photographs of, because I tend to go into it, like, I would go to O'Connell Street, and I wouldn't plan, like, one of my hobbies is transport photography. If a bus was on the street, I take a photograph of it, but I can't plan for that bus to be there. I can plan for a bus to be there, but not a particular bus I take a photograph of, if that makes sense at all.
Well, what I would say to you, though, Linda, is the fact that you went out to O'Connell Street means that there was a certain intent. You went out to photograph transport. So if you like what Gregory Crewsden and Jeff Wall do, is they direct. So there's a very famous image by Jeff Wall, it's called Blink, and it looks like a street photograph, but actually it's a staged photograph, and it's a scene that he saw himself. If you looked at the video last week, he talked about how he starts by not photographing. So there are a lot of things that he would have seen, scenes that he caught, a glance that he saw on the street, and Blink is a staged photograph, but it's of a moment that he saw. So, you know, it's just a legitimate strategy to represent something as yourself, Linda, going out to photograph in O'Connell Street, to photograph the buses, in my opinion.
Yeah. Okay. It depends too. I mean, it's certainly, I mean, if you're taking photographs of people, you have to direct them. You have to say, you stand there, whatever. Yeah, I can see your point certainly about that, all right.
Yeah, and there's also a tradition in portraiture where you photograph people when they're not aware that you're photographing them.
Yeah.
But even that, and it, you know, so it's commonly known as street photography, and it would involve, it would be particularly in the genre that's known as street photography. But even that involves staging. So you have to go out and you have to stand in this particular place at a particular time, and you have to wait for the moment to come together, if you like, in front of you. So even that has a certain amount of staging. So anyway, the point I'm trying to make is not so much about whether. I just think they have an interesting way of working. They take a methodology that's been used in the movie industry since the movie industry began. They are, if you like, directing, staging, putting on a show, and then they photograph it. So you can look at their images. They make really interesting work, really rich in narrative. I recommend you look them up.
Okay.
I'm going to move on just because of the time. This is the last photography club, and I wanted to suggest a couple of things that might help you keep working. The first one is to continue to stare, pry, listen, eavesdrop. That's the quote from last week. So keep on getting out there. Keep on doing what you're doing. You're doing great. The second thing is, I can't under-emphasize the importance of keeping a sketchbook and a journal. Fill it with your thoughts, your observation, your photos, your drawings, etc. There is a link there to a webpage that will bring you to a book called Photographer Sketchbooks. It's a book of sketchbooks that were published by somebody on Contemporary Photographers Sketchbooks, including Alex Soth, which is a photographer that we looked at earlier in this series of talks. So I would highly recommend that you keep a sketchbook. I keep a sketchbook, a journal sketchbook where I write things down, I write my thoughts down, I keep photographs. See it? Okay, so this one's almost full, but pretty much everything that I've been to in terms of gallery visits, thoughts, there's some scribblings in here. I'm not much of a drawer. When I was on the so there's a sketchbook here. There's ideas for. There's a sketch here I made when I was making a camera lucida. I don't know whether you. I'm sorry, camera obscura. Do you know what a camera obscura is?
Yep.
Yeah.
Camera obscura is the original. Cameras have been around since about the 11th century, but we had no way to capture the image and make it stay. So various different painters, in fact, if David Hockney has a famous series of videos or famous film where he considers the influence of lenses and the camera obscura and how it suddenly changed Western art in around the 13 and 1400s. Suddenly we went from kind of, you know, the flat, two-dimensional to showing space. Everything changed, and his synopsis is that it's the influence of lenses and the way people would have used camera obscura. There's a lot of famous artists who we know for a fact they use camera obscura to project an image into a canvas, and then they would have painted it in. So it's the original black box. You can make one in a room very simply. If you have a room with a window, like this room that I'm sitting in just has one window, And I could, if I blocked that window, if I put black paper on it, and then I cut a tiny little hole in it, it will project an image onto the opposite wall. The image is upside down. That's the beginning of camera technology. That's the beginning of the cameras that we use today. That's where it all started. So, so anyway, I digress. So I consider keeping this group going. Meet up online, share your thoughts, and share your love of photography. Okay. I can't underemphasize the importance of sharing, meeting regularly with like-minded people who share your passion and your love for something. Okay. So I don't know how you would keep this group going, but there's a good cohort of people here now. I think that, you know, if you're interested, Bridget, would we be able to do something to help out there?
Bridget's gone. She's gone.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So
we could use something like WhatsApp.
Yeah, I'm not really thinking about WhatsApp. Sure, it's up to you guys what you want to do. But what I find about WhatsApp is, I wasn't so much thinking about that, but I have a group of people that I studied with from the last part of my degree. And there are four of us that meet once a month to discuss and share work. So, you know, I would highly recommend if you can do that in some shape or form. I wasn't so much thinking, there's nothing wrong with WhatsApp, but WhatsApp is... there's so much stuff comes in on WhatsApp that it's easy. There's no depth to the discussion, if you know what I mean, Linda. You know, and I think if you want to move forward with your photography, you need to be sharing work and discussing it and reviewing it and talking about the things that we've talked about, you know, here today. Okay? Obviously, you need to see as much work as you possibly can. With gallery visits, looking at websites, photo books, anywhere you get a chance, movies. So I've included some galleries that I recommend you visit. The library project is part of the PhotoIreland Foundation. It's in Temple Bar. They have a gallery there and a bookshop. The 2020 PhotoIreland Festival is going ahead in July, as far as I know. I highly recommend you support it if it does go ahead, but check it out anyway. The PhotoIreland Foundation is a fantastic foundation in terms of supporting contemporary Irish photography and contemporary Irish photographers. It's very open and inclusive, and they also run great, I doubt it'll be running this year, but last year and the year before, it's usually a great series of talks and workshops that happens as part of the PhotoIreland Festival. I just think the PhotoIreland Festival is a great festival. There's obviously also in Meeting House Square, there's the Gallery of Photography. And actually, I forgot to include it. There's the National Archives have a place opposite the Gallery of Photography where they show photographs from the National Collection. Irish Museum of Modern Art and then the National Gallery of Ireland. Okay. I've also included some recommended reading. I talked about it. So Train Your Gaze. Is the book that a lot of the work that we did here was taken from. The Photograph of as Contemporary Art by Charlotte Cotton. I use that book a lot in preparing for these talks. Remember, Lucida, anybody who wants to know anything about photography, a lot of contemporary photography is influenced by Cameron Lucida, and also Image Music Text, Roland Barth. On Photography, Susan Sontag. Ways of Seeing, fantastic series. Started out as a book. And went on to be a TV series. The TV series is on YouTube. Don't have to write any of these down. You'll get them all tomorrow. There's a brilliant series of books by Bloomsbury. Basic Creative Photography series. There's a whole series of books in that series. Look them up. I recommend any of them. I have nearly them all, I think. This one here, Perspectives on Place, Theory and Practice in Landscape Photography. If anybody is interested in landscape, great book as well by J.A.P. Alexander or Jesse Alexander. Jesse was a course leader in the college where I studied. It's a very good book. I don't have it in front of me. Anyway, it's a very good book. And then Approaching Photography, Paul Hill. Excellent book as well. Really, really good book. Okay?
Okay.
You have an optional final assignment. I'll send out the text tomorrow. And it's whatever format you use, mount your camera, with a cable release attached on a tripod. This will slow you down, encourage you to pay a special kind of attention to what you're looking at. Before you do anything else, the term, so it's really step by step about how to take a photograph. It's asking you to slow down and consider what you're photographing. You're going to make a portrait of somebody else if you want to do this. And the idea is to put them in the center of the frame, okay? It'll come out tomorrow and you can read it fully tomorrow, okay? All the text is there. If you want to do it and send it in, okay? It's optional, like all of them are optional. And again, it's from
Brian.
Yeah?
My phone, I use my phone and I'm no tripod available.
Okay. That's okay. You can, the idea of using, Linda, the idea of using a tripod, if you use a tripod, you don't have to use a tripod. You can do other things. The idea is to make you slow down and really focus on what you're doing. So you could put your camera on something else. You know, I realize that not everybody, first of all, I know that not everybody's using a camera. In fact, anything that I've done here has all been done on the phone. It's not so much about whether you put it on a tripod or not. It's more to do with following the other directions. If you can't put it on a tripod, don't worry about it. Okay?
Yep.
Okay.
And then lastly, I'd like to just say thank you to everybody who's come along. This is the last in the series. So
thank you too.
Yeah. Thank you, Brian. That was very interesting. I enjoyed
that
it.
That was brilliant.
Thank you.
Yes, that was really interesting.
Well, I have to say that I've got a lot out of doing this. I've really enjoyed it, and it was great. It was really interesting to have such a whole lot of people who are really engaged here, you know. And there's been some really great observations and feedback and things like that. And looking at the work has been really interesting to me. You'll notice that I was talking about this last night with my wife. I deliberately don't talk about composition or what's good or what's bad, because I just think that when you can put so much in your way, you know. And a lot of, I think, where good art comes from is unlearning all the rules, you know. So I deliberately haven't set a lot of rules, you know. So yeah, it's been, I've learned a lot. In terms of preparing for the reading I had to do, I've learned a lot about using Zoom, and I've learned a lot about looking at the work that's submitted, you know. So it's been a real pleasure. So thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Brian. It's been wonderful.
Thanks, Brian.
Thank you.
Bye
very
bye.
Much.
That was
really Brian. Interesting. Really
bye bye.
Okay. Bye. Thanks very much. Yeah, if nobody has anything else to say, then we'll call it a day at that. But if anybody would like to say anything, then go ahead. Are we good?
Yeah.
Good.
Dublin. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Thanks. See you all.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.